A big thank you to Father Veselin and His Grace Bishop Silwan for making this possible tonight. It is a great honor for us and a blessing, a very big blessing, to be here with you and to celebrate the Vespers with you and also say a few words. You have a very special family here, and of course it's not a big family, but enjoy it while it's small, because it will not be small forever, and you will look back to the beginnings and you will see how nice it was. Not that it will not be nice when the family grows, but it's a different feeling. So enjoy this small family you've got while it lasts. And today we will say a few things about the spiritual life in the modern world. Before I left Perth, a young boy came to me for confession. He is 9 years old. He's not Greek, he's not Serbian, he's not Australian. It doesn't matter what nationality he is. He speaks English. So he came for confession. He comes a few times every year. He's a tiny boy. And this child has the feeling that confession is something very important for him. So we sat down, we spoke, he read the list that he had written down for confession. And after, he asked me a question that was troubling him. It was a very simple thing that had to do with his school and some friends and how things are going there. But it was so important to him that he was like expecting my answer as if it was something so important for his salvation, although it was a very simple subject. So what I'm trying to say here is that if we don't teach our children from a young age to go for confession and to talk about their problems and to ask questions to their spiritual fathers, when they grow, when they become teenagers, there is no chance that they will stay in the church, and they will have a great difficulty talking about their problems with their spiritual father, with their confessor father. So it has to start from a young age. Otherwise, it's very difficult. It can definitely happen later on as well, but it will be very difficult. Now, this young boy, one of the previous times, he asked me, what does someone need to become a priest? So what I'm trying to say is not if this boy will become a priest or not. What I'm trying to say is that he's an altar boy. He looks up to us. And his role model is someone who's in the church, someone who's a monk, someone who's a priest. Compare this role model of this child with the role models that the young generation has today, and you can understand that there is a difference there. So regardless if this child will become a priest or an astronaut, it doesn't matter. What matters is that when he goes to the next stage in his life, when he becomes a teenager, he will know what's right and what's wrong. And he will know when he does something wrong that he has to go for confession. But if you try to teach this child 10 years later, it will be too late. My first personal experience with confession was when I was in the kindergarten. And my grandmother, who was very close to the church, called me for confession. He was a very old and respectable priest. I told him a few things. I didn't really have much to say. But God gave me a very special experience at this day. I kneeled, he read the prayer on me, and I felt like after the prayer, when I stood up, I had no weight. I felt like I was flying. I don't know how to express it. I can never forget this experience, and this is what kept me closer to the church. So again, to where I started from, if we don't teach our children from a young age to have a spiritual father, later on in their lives, they will go through a lot of problems and they will not have the assistance that they could have if they were close to the church. So if anybody asks what's the age for someone to bring his children to the church, I would say, as far as they understand and they can talk, just bring them in. The confession will not be perfect, but the confession is a sacrament, and the blessing they will get from the priest cannot be replaced with anything else on this planet. Now, another thing on the same subject. There was a family where I come from, in the island where I was born, and the husband and the wife, they had a big problem. The problem was that when the father was telling off the children, the wife, although she knew that what the father was doing was right, she couldn't handle it. So she would get involved, and then the situation will end up with a fight between the mother and the father. And they couldn't work out what to do. So they went to their spiritual father. They had the same spiritual father. And the spiritual father saved the family because it was getting really bad. So he told the wife, the husband is the one who's strongest from the couple, for this specific couple. And he told the wife, when the father tells off your son, you go to another room. They did that, and they saved their marriage, which is such something so simple. But their marriage was in trouble just because they couldn't handle, they didn't know how to deal with this situation. And what I'm trying to tell you here is that the husband and the wife, they need to have the same spiritual father, because if problems arise within the family, he will be the one to tell them what to do. And if they have learned a little bit of obedience in their lives, this can literally save their marriage. Now, these were a few things about repentance. Now we'll say a few things about humility. And all these things that we'll talk about, repentance, humility, obedience, and prayer, they have to do with our spiritual life in this modern world, in simple words. Now, when Jesus washed his disciples' feet, this was during the Last Supper, we would say that this was a very humble thing to do for him. He was God, he became human. Back then, they were wearing sandals and they were walking on dirt roads, so their feet, they would be very dirty. And Jesus, although he knew who he was, he did what he did. But the real humility of Jesus was not to wash his disciples' feet. The real humility of Jesus was to become human. He was God. He was something totally different, something uncomprehensible, and he became something which is so limited. This was the real humility. So washing his disciples' feet was just a lesson he had to give to his disciples, to tell them not to be embarrassed, to do whatever it takes if this was to help someone. Washing someone's feet, back then he did literally, but how could we wash someone's feet in our society? It's like when we stand next to them when they have pain, when they have psychological pain, when they struggle from thoughts. Washing their feet is like cleaning the dirt from their intellect when this gets dirty going through the paths of our lives. And in this way, we can serve our brothers and sisters. So, being humble is not doing humiliating acts. Being humble is knowing where we come from and when we're heading. This is what Jesus did. He knew who he was. He knew where he was coming from and where he was heading. So for him to wash his disciples' feet was nothing, was something important, something he had to do. So when we know where we are coming from and where we are heading to, there is no action that could be humble. There is no action that could be humiliating for us. There is no humility. Humility is all in the way that we think. If we think that something is humbling, something is humiliating, we think that by doing this thing we will humble ourselves. But that's not how things work. There is no job in the world that is humble or humiliating, and there is nothing that could humble us or humiliate us if we know who we are. So I know I'm Greek. If someone calls me a different nationality, it doesn't make any difference for me because I know that I'm Greek. And it doesn't mean that this is good or bad. It means that this is who I am. The same way, if someone calls us names, it doesn't change anything in us because we are who we are. And if we have our relationship with God, this cannot humble us. This cannot humiliate us. But if we play our role in the humanity right, this is the humble thing to do. So when Virgin Mary, when Panagia was asked from the angel to incarnate Christ, to give birth to God, she could have said, I'm human, and out of humility I just can't accept that, I can't understand it anyway, so how I can't accept it, I can't do it. If she was to be humble in this way, all of us, we would have lost our chance to be saved. We would have lost our salvation. So the humble thing was not to say, I'm human, I can't do what you're asking me, but the humble thing, the humiliating thing for Christ would have been if a human was to refuse his incarnation. What I'm trying to tell you is that being humble is not doing something specific. Being humble is doing what God asks us. And he might ask us to be something which doesn't look humble. But if we accept it by letting ourselves in his hands, like Panagia did, we can be the cause of salvation of thousands of people. And even if we can't save anybody else than ourselves, this is good enough. This is good enough. And our example can inspire others around us, and this will be greater than what we ever thought it could be. So, humility is to accept the responsibilities and the roles that God is giving us. Also, humility, we could say, is to let things go if people have hurt us, if they have misjudged us, if they throw smart comments on us. And humility is also to recognize someone else's value and to be happy for his happiness. And we have to think here the example of St. John the Forerunner. Jesus says that he was the greatest man ever born. And when he realized who Jesus was, he told his disciples, don't worry about me, just follow him. So basically, all the work he ever did for the good and the salvation of people, he gave it away. Why? Because he knew that he was there to serve a person, a purpose. He knew where he was coming from and where he was going. And he gave up everything he stood for because this was his purpose. And we have to think alike when our children are trying to go closer to God. There are lots of examples that the parents, they don't want their children to fast, or they're trying to tell their kids that they don't need to pray too much and this and that. So basically, we're trying to keep our children to ourselves. But this means we are making ourselves God. And this is idolatry. We can't replace God. If our children want to go closer to God, we have to encourage them, not to tell them not to go closer to God. And sometimes humility is also to pretend that we enjoy something in our family and we enjoy something within our friendly environment just to make others happy. And this is how we can empty ourselves in order for our family to be happy. Now, all these things that we said about humility, if we don't want to empty ourselves, we just can't follow them. And we can always find plenty of excuses not to do what we have to do. Now, the next thing we will talk about in the spiritual life, in our everyday world, is about obedience. Some people, they say, happy wife, happy life. And it's the other way around, of course. But this means that our priority has to be the other people that they are in our lives, that God gave us in our lives. So our priorities is not what we want, what we think, what we need, but what the other half of ourselves needs and wants and will help him or her to go closer to God. So obedience is not just to our spiritual father, but obedience exists within the family as well. Obedience is not if we were advised to do a certain set of prayers and we struggle to push ourselves to the point that we will give up everything. That's not obedience. That's just not knowing our limits and not being humble enough to admit that our limits are less than what we thought they are. Obedience that does not exist without confession of our thoughts and our difficulties that we face. So if we struggle with something and our spiritual father gave us a rule, something to follow in obedience, if we struggle with it, we have to go back and tell him, I tried, I can't do it, what do you suggest I do now? We cannot just push ourselves to the limits and then just forget about church because we just can't do it. Also, obedience does not mean if our spiritual father told us to fast and we live in a family of non-practicing Christians to start fights in the name of what our spiritual father advised us to do. Obedience has to be done in a way that we do not create problems in our immediate environment. And we can never say, my elder told me to do this, and then if this person cannot handle what we're telling him, it's like we turn this person against our elder, against someone who represents Christ. That's not wise. Obedience is an inner absence of reaction and an inner desire to please our God through following the instructions of our spiritual father or our spouse, if it has to do with our family matters. We see them as if we see Christ himself, and therefore we love and respect everything they ask for, everything they are, or everything that they represent. We need to be careful from familiarity when we talk about obedience. If we lose the respect and we see our spiritual father as a friend, we can easily override him and think we know better, or it doesn't really matter if we do not follow the exact instructions, and then this is a big mistake. Obedience basically means self-denial. The worst struggle is to refuse our logic and our so-called rights. Our entitlements and the virtues or qualities we think we possess. But without giving up ourselves, there is no spiritual freedom. Also, we should not panic even after the worst disobedience we might have done. Otherwise, more mistakes will follow and we will lose everything. This is how the original sin happened. So Adam and Eve, they disobeyed, but then the tempter managed to make them behave in a selfish way. So they panicked, they couldn't accept themselves. They had this false idea of themselves being someone. And then when God told them, what did you do? They couldn't admit that they did something wrong. So what threw them out of paradise was not the disobedience, but it was not admitting. It was the lack of repentance, the lack of accepting that they were wrong. So if we're wrong, if we do something wrong, if we do something terrible, if we kill someone, we have to admit it and repent and start fresh. If we don't do so, it's not the murder that we committed that will throw us out of heaven, but it's the focus on ourselves, when we would have to deny ourselves, admit our mistake, and run towards Christ for our salvation. It was the same example when Cain, you know the story from the Old Testament about the two brothers, Cain and Abel. So when the one killed the other because he was jealous, God appeared to Cain and asked him, where is your brother? And he got all defensive. He said, why do you expect me to be the guardian of my brother or something? And basically he refused his sin, and that's why he could not be forgiven. But God told him something very important. He told him, you sinned, be peaceful. It doesn't make any sense to us if we think about it. But this is what should happen. After we sin, we should not panic. After we sin, we should keep our calm, and we should realize that, all right, I did a mistake. I will admit it and I'm moving forward. Because if we panic and if we think that we should protect our name, we should protect what others think about us, we should protect the idea that our spiritual father has for us, we basically lock ourselves out of heaven. So this is where humility comes, and with repentance gets us closer to God. If we want others to think that we are somebody, and if we want our spiritual father to think that we are spiritual, basically we just lost our only chance we had to make it to heaven, because we only have one life and we only have one chance. And now we go to prayer. When we say prayers, it doesn't necessarily mean that we pray, and when we pray, we might not necessarily say prayers. I heard this recently and I was very impressed, so that's not my wisdom. And what it means is that we might be saying prayers in the church or when we pray in our room, but if our soul doesn't participate, it's not like we pray. It's like we just read things. And at the same time, we might go through times in our lives that the pain inside us is so strong that it could never be expressed with words. It could never be expressed with prayers. But this is a stronger prayer, because our soul moves towards God, asking for an answer, asking for salvation, asking for understanding, asking for Him to be present in our lives. And this is a stronger prayer that we could ever do, and this doesn't need words. So we need to replace our unceasing thoughts with unceasing prayer. And what do we mean by unceasing prayer, going back to what we just said before? You've all heard about Elder Sophronius from Essex. He was a very spiritual person. We believe he is a saint. He's not canonized yet, of course. But he had a doctor. He was a professor of cardiology from Athens, the University of Athens, and he was visiting him very often. He was his personal doctor, and this professor was also confessing to Elder Sophronio. So once he had a dream with Elder Sophronio, this professor, and the professor was doing operations of open heart. So Saint Elder Sophronius appeared to him and told him, "My doctor, you have to pray unceasingly." And the professor asked, "Yerda, if I do this, I will kill someone. I'm performing operations with open heart. How can I pray unceasingly?" And Elder Sophronius replied, "You didn't understand. You have to do this." And he opened his hands like this. This is what the professor was literally doing when he was opening hearts, operating hearts. But this is what Elder Sophronius told him as well, that unceasing prayer is to keep your heart open in front of God at all times. So basically, you don't need words. What you need to do is to want God to see your thoughts, to see your heart at all times. And if you have this desire, then God is there. God will be with you all the time, and you have a relationship, you have a communication with God at all times without doing anything, just by wanting Him to be present in your life, wanting Him to be present in your heart, and wanting Him to know all your thoughts, the worst ones, and ask Him to help you to get rid of all these thoughts. That's unceasing prayer. Of course, there are other ways of unceasing prayer as well, but I think this is the easiest way. Now, another thing we might need to mention here is to try, before talking back to someone irritating, to focus, let's say, on three Jesus prayers before we reply, so someone gets us upset. If we want to get the temptation out of the picture, before talking back, our husband, our wife told us something and we get irritated. Before talking back, just try to get your attention away from what just happened and focus for three times saying, "Jesus, pray, Lord Jesus Christ, have mercy upon me, a sinner." But try and focus for three times. Say this three times. And if you do this, then I believe that 50% of the anger will go away. And when we are to say what we have to say, it will come out more loving. It will come out more understanding. And the temptation will not win against us 100%. Focusing on prayer can be hard, but the ones who knock will get an open door. So if we do our best and wait, then on time prayer will become easier and God will answer to the desires of our heart. Also, we should not expect God to hear us when we pray because we need something. This could be for our health or for our future. And they look like important things to us. But imagine a father who is a millionaire having his own son contacting him only when he needs a lollipop. This is what our prayers are like. My back hurts and I pray for my back. Of course, I will pray for my back, but this is not the most important thing for my salvation. And God has so many things to give me that I'm asking for a useless thing. And because He's so rich, this is an insult. But we all do it, me first. And it's like we're not interested in the rest of our Father's wealth, and we just care about a childish little thing. Prayer gets us closer to God and enables us to commune mystically with Him. And this is what we should be aiming for. Now, this is what I had to tell you for today, but before you ask me questions, I want to ask you some questions. And if anybody wants to answer, please do. So, I've got some questions for you. If I go for confession and I keep repeating the same sins, should I just wait until I get better and go for confession then? Any ideas? And then I'll tell you my opinion, but I want to hear your opinions first. So if I go for confession and I keep repeating the same sins, should I just wait until I get better and then go for confession? Anyone?
No.
All right.
As long as it takes, just keep going.
Meaning?
Try to don't give up.
But should I go for confession or no?
Yes.
Okay.
Keep going.
All right. All right. So good. You got the first answer right. So when your hands get dirty, you wash them. You don't wait until you learn not to get them dirty. Otherwise, we will always be dirty. Not to be afraid or embarrassed of our sins. Self-knowledge will help us there. If I believe that I'm not worthy of something... Okay, I need my glasses, but I don't have them, so it's okay. Or maybe I do. Father, can you give me my glasses, please? Thank you. Someone is getting old. Thank you, Father. Thank you. Okay, let's see if that's better. All right, if I believe that I'm not worthy. Okay, let's go again. That's a difficult one to explain, and I can't even read it correctly. If I believe that I'm not worthy of not existing, but not worthy of not existing, then what's the big news about me sinning? I have to explain this. All right. Sometimes we think that we're not worthy of existing. But have we ever thought that we're not worthy of even not existing? This means that we get so disappointed from ourselves that we think that if God didn't create us, He would have done right. But we don't deserve even not being created if these things could ever exist. I don't know if I make any sense. But what I'm trying to say is that this is how disappointed we can get from ourselves. That we don't exist even not to be created. Not we don't exist to be created, but we don't exist even not to be created. That's how disappointed we can get from ourselves. But yet, Jesus became human for our salvation. And all it takes is for us to say a yes and try a little bit. And He does the rest. And I'm not saying it's an easy way, but I'm saying that there is a way out. So I will do my best not to sadden, not to make sad my Lord, but I will get myself cleaned up as soon as possible. And this brings me to my second question. For some reason, I am not comfortable with my confessor father. What should I do? Any ideas? I hope you never get to this point, but it's an interesting point. Let's say that I'm not comfortable with my confessor father. What should I do?
Confess it.
Yes. You have to confess it, but if the problem continues, what do you do?
Find another one.
That's right. No one is irreplaceable. And I'm not saying this with the sense of not respecting our spiritual father, But in the Orthodox Church, we can change spiritual fathers until we find the one who talks to our heart. But then, when our ego kicks in, we need to fight our ego and stay obedient to him. Otherwise, we will never grow spiritually. So we are free to change spiritual fathers, but we have to find someone that gives us comfort. And once we do, do your best not to lose him, because if you do, it will be from our own ego and not because this spiritual father did something wrong. Next question. They are treating me in a way which suffocates me. Should I endure to be humble or to practice humility or do something else? What do you suggest? So they are treating me in a way which suffocates me. Should I endure to be a humble person or to practice humility by enduring? What do you suggest? It's interesting, I'm asking the questions. But I need some answers. Any idea? I don't know if you understood the question.
If you're suffocating, you could die, so you don't want to be in that position.
That's metaphorically. Yes, right. But metaphorically, so, yes.
Metaphorically.
Yes. So that's right.
Don't stay in that, you know, try to find another way, possibly.
Yes. Yes. All right. Let's see what I've written down. Can't remember. All right. We need to know our limits. Otherwise, we might compress our feelings more than what we can handle and then explode in an ugly way or get affected psychologically. If we cannot easily be an accurate judge of a situation, we can always ask advice from our spiritual father. So if we see that we cannot handle a situation, we have to talk with our spiritual father, because compressing ourselves more than what we can handle sometimes can be very, very unhealthy, and it can result in us getting traumatized if we don't know our limits. So it takes a lifetime to understand our limits, and not in a proud way, but in a realistic way. Once I know that there is something I can't stand, and that's not because, of course I'm not humble, but I can't stand it at the moment. I don't have the level of humility that it takes for me to handle this situation. Then I have to be humble enough to avoid the situation and talk with my spiritual father about it. Otherwise I can damage myself. And this is the same with people that they try to do more than what they can handle, and then they end up exhausted, and then they just give up the whole thing. So we need to try and find our limits. Now, the next question. How do I become humble? I wish I knew. Anyone? Any thoughts?
Silence.
Yeah.
Silence.
Yeah. Every little bit helps. Okay. Now, humility is a gift from God. Try to ask for it, and you will see how quickly God listens to your prayers. But you will be hammered from every possible direction to chisel away your ego. You can train yourselves, though. If we consciously lower ourselves in every aspect, we prepare ourselves for the grace of humility. Fasting, making others' needs as priorities, not reacting in every action against us, are ways to refocus from ourselves to God and our fellow men. So every person that I know that has asked for humility, they got their answers prayed right away. But it's so humbling that, including myself, of course, we go back to the one who suggested us all to our thoughts that suggested us to ask for humility. And we ask, why did I ask for it? I can't handle it. It's very difficult. But this is the reality. But if we can ask for it and endure, we will get a lot out of it. The reality is that we know ourselves, and if we think that we can do few small things that they will lower our ego, we should do them, because that's a good practice for becoming more humble. And then if we pray for it, God can give us the courage to do more, and will give us the grace to become more humble. I've got another question. Do I have to be obedient to everyone around me? No? It's a difficult one. All right. We should be obedient to our spiritual father for spiritual matters, or matters that are not spiritual as such, but they can influence us spiritually. Other than that, the easier people can find comfort on us, and the more we respect others, the closer we get to Christ. I am not telling you to rob someone if your friend asks you to, but first, why would you have such friends if you are after spiritual life? Second, you should see in everyone's face Christ, so you cannot hurt anyone if you are asked by someone else. And third, you should create a unifying distance around you. This way, you will have your own boundaries, which will be known and respected from your immediate environment. They will not come to you for gossiping, and they will not ask you to do anything dodgy. Elder Milianos used to talk about this, the unifying distance. So if you want really to have a connection with others, you have to create an atmosphere of respect, and this is a distance. Without it, the familiarity can get us to points that we should never get to. So if you want to truly have a communion in Christ with someone, you need these boundaries. You need this unifying distance. And this is very important to remember. And fourth, avoid tempting situations the way gunpowder should avoid fire. Otherwise, explosions will naturally follow. Okay. I've got three more questions. All right. The one is, should I demand my children to be obedient to me? What do you think? Lots of people have children, I guess, or are about to. Huh?
You have
yes?
To be open to the suggestion, first of all, I think.
This is a big debate.
Yes and no.
Yes and no?
I think yes and no. You can't expect them to do everything you want, but you did. There are certain things that are important that they should
all right.
Be obedient to, I think.
Okay. So, our children, before becoming teenagers, they need to know who the boss is. It's not tyranny. It's a loving relationship, but only one can be the boss. And this boss will have to be obedient to a number of things, but the parents are the parents. And what do I mean by this? That the parents, sometimes they have to be obedient to the children, but the parents are the parents. They have the responsibility, and they do whatever they do out of love. So the children, one, before they become teenagers, they have to listen. Now, when they become teenagers, the fruit of their right upbringing will shine or not. Then the parents are not the boss anymore, literally, because No one cares about what the parents talk about. They are the ones that pray for their children, and may God help us all. So St. Paisius used to say, that's where God is from, that before your children become teenagers, do your best, get them close to the church, confession, Holy Communion, everything possible. The first day that they become teenagers, that just pray for them. If you try to push them, you will end up with the extreme opposite results. This is why it is so important to start talking about God to our children from a young age. Otherwise, when they become teenagers, we lost the game. And of course, if we did our best and then they become teenagers and they go away, like St. Nicodemus of Mount Athos says, give me a child for the first 7 years of its life and then don't worry about it. They have inside them the right seeds that on time they will grow. It doesn't matter if they rebel a little bit. It doesn't matter if they go away a little bit. They will come back because they have a conscience. Unless they get involved with drugs. And then it's very, very difficult. And it's not, the conscience doesn't always work after people have experienced some strong drugs. Anybody wants to add anything? Oh. Next question. How much, that's about prayer now. How much and how should I pray when I have a family or a job or I don't have much time, etc.? Any suggestions? It's interesting, I'm asking the questions and I'm answering the questions. All right. So prayer rules are set after talking with our spiritual father. But practicing Jesus' prayer means that you have a spiritual father who practices it too. Otherwise, you are in the wrong specialist's practice. So, about how much we pray and when we pray, we talk about it with our spiritual father. But in case someone wants to practice Jesus' prayer, he also needs, or she also needs, a spiritual father who knows about this subject, who practices this subject. If my spiritual father doesn't practice Jesus' prayer, I can't ask him for it. I can't ask advice from him. So, when we have not much time, if we can put our heart into the prayer, then these 5 minutes can be more effective than if we had 5 hours of prayer. And when, let's say that there are a few occasions that we pray and we feel this peace, we feel this happiness, we feel this joy, we feel something different. In these times that we feel this special something from God, when we do and if we do, if we are smart at this specific time, we can ask God for something which is important for our spiritual life. And Elder Mileno says that when there are such times and we ask for whatever our heart desires, but it's what our conscience tells us, and not something like make me a millionaire, something like that. When we have special moments of prayer and we ask for something that we spiritually need, God will give it to us. So how much we pray, our spiritual father will tell us. If we want to practice Jesus' prayer, we need a spiritual father that also practices Jesus' prayer. And if we have special moments in our prayer, we should use them. Like ask God then and there, I need this, take away my anger if that's a problem in the family. Or make me a better person. Or help my children get closer to you. God listens. God listens. And the last question. Should I push my children to pray? That's similar to something we said before, but what do you think? No one knows?
Maybe you should force the habit, but maybe not force the prayer. Or teach the habit.
Yeah. So,
Encourage them.
Yes, correct. So Orthodoxy lays on our freedom, not on rules and obligations. If we give the right example, the children respect and follow it. How can you talk about prayer if you scream at them? How can you talk about prayer if you swear? How can you teach them about prayer when your example cannot convince them that prayer changes people? So, if we want a spiritual life for our families, we have to be the example. And that's the end of the story. We can't ask people, we can't ask of people to be spiritual and ourselves to act as if there is no control in anything. And even if our family doesn't follow our example, this example does not go waste. I believe that it stays inside us, and on time, it will help us overcome a difficulty. Like, there are adults that they always remember how their mothers were praying every day in front of the icons, and how their mothers were anxious when these children were doing stupid things. But they wouldn't say anything. They would go in front of the icons and tell Panagia, tell Theotokos, that protect my son, protect my daughter. These things, they are not things that someone can forget. And regardless where life finds us a few years down the track, there are things that they are engraved inside us. And they can last for a whole life. And these memories, when we reach rock bottom, they can help us get up. And this is what matters. So the example is what matters, and not pushing anyone. I know of a chanta who had a number of sons, 5, 7, I can't remember how many. And he was getting them every Sunday with him to church from very early until the end of the service. He was enjoying his chanting. The kids, they grew up. None of them wants to hear about church. He keeps chanting, but his sons, they don't want to hear about church. They live their lives, and they are all over the place, in a very bad way, some of them. So pushing them, it's not always the best solution. And just a couple of days ago, a father called me and he said, tomorrow I want to bring my family to the church because it's St. John's celebration, the monastery celebration. And then the next day we fly for Europe, so I wanted us to have a blessed day. And my son all of a sudden wants to go to school to say goodbye to his friends. They couldn't convince him. He was a very young kid. And they didn't know what to do. Both parents, they were like, they didn't know what to do. And they asked me, and I said, you can only suggest what's right and then just pray for the best. So they did that. And the morning when the son woke up, he said, oh, maybe I'll come with you to the church. If they were to push him, he would have gone to the church, but he would have been so disappointed from this force, from this pressure, that it wouldn't have worked in a positive way. And then again, he could have not come to the church. But I believe that for those kids that they have a conscience, it would have worked in a positive way, not going to the church, because his conscience would have told him, I should have gone to the church. And that's what matters, not just going to the church once or twice. All right, I said too much. If you have any questions other than mine. It's not good if I have the questions and I answer them, because then no questions? That's good.
Maybe I'll break the ice.
Okay.
Could you tell us just a little bit more on what Elder Milianos was saying about that healthy distance, or that, how do you call it? Unifying
distance.
Yeah.
So what was very impressive about Elder Milianos was that his whole presence was as if he was a prince. And I will explain this. He would always look proper with clean clothes and like presentable, and I don't know if you've heard of Elder Ephrem Katunakiotis. He's another contemporary elder who passed away, and he's a saint. So when Elder Milianos went to him the first time, Elder Ephrem, who was an ascetic, he was living in the desert, he saw him dressed like an archimandrite, I would say. And he thought, oh, he wouldn't have any idea about God. But then he said to himself, how about if I go and pray for a minute before I judge the person? So he went and prayed, and God gave him the information that in Yerdes Emilianos' face, he was to found a second Joseph the Hesychast, who was his elder. That's how great Elder Milianos was. So what I'm trying to say is that his presence would inspire your respect. Respect in a way that you couldn't say a stupid joke to him. Not because you wouldn't say a joke, but you wouldn't say a joke that it would make you embarrassed. You had this respect. His presence was so respectful that you couldn't just joke around. And you could never tell him bad things about others. Like, not if these were your thoughts and you were confessing them, but if you were with the intention to gossip someone, because you would not find him assisting you with that. So if our presence is such that we inspire respect, because you can't force someone to respect you, you either inspire it or you don't, then this respect is the boundaries around us that they secure us from the easy falls. First of all, we have to respect ourselves. Otherwise, we can't inspire others to respect us. But, for example, when someone doesn't talk all the time, but talks when he should and says what he should say, others know that they cannot make this person judge someone. And they respect that. And that's a boundary, that's a distance, which unifies these people. Because the sins, they don't unify people. They divide the people within themselves and with others. They create a distance with others. Because wherever the sin gets involved, the tempter gets there, and then there is a split personality problem.
So and this, the one that wants to gossip will find the one that wants to hear the gossip.
Yes. Yes. So if we're not such people, people will understand it and they will not tempt us with such temptations. And this distance unifies us with others through God. It's a concept that me, myself, being in Simonopetra, I knew the presence of Herod and the respect and everything, but phrased like as I said it, I heard it afterwards, like this year, from a video that someone did, and Elder Eliseus was talking, the abbot the abbot who is there now was talking about Elder Milianos. And the reporter, who was a spiritual child of Elder Milianos, talked about the unifying distance. And it made sense all of a sudden, although I never heard this phrase. It made sense because this was what he was all about. You had no chance, no possibility other than respecting him, because he would inspire this distance which would unify you with him and with God. So, yeah.
And what could you suggest to someone who would say to you, I understand what's right, but sometimes the peer pressure,
the what?
The pressure from the people around me is so strong, especially nowadays, and for the younger people and the teenagers, sometimes it's either I cannot resist, or I will find myself being exorcised, how it's called.
Being out, yes.
Yes, that's when everything else has to work. And what I mean by everything else, the way that this person was brought up. If this person has an inner spiritual life, if this person loves God, if this person takes his salvation seriously, and if this person does, then you keep a distance from the people that they don't help you spiritually, and you don't do something that you think twice before doing something that you know that will separate you from God. So the pressure is always there, the temptations will always be there, but eventually we need to learn how to avoid the temptations and also overcome them. Say it again.
You mentioned just then about forming a distance to try and lessen the pressure. So you surround yourself with spiritual stuff to lessen that pressure. What about if it's either a child that's in school, so it's in a classroom, for example, and they can't just remove themselves from the classroom? Maybe they don't have to be friends with those people that are doing that.
You're talking about when you have bullying situations.
Not so much that, not so much a pressure to do something.
Yes.
You say remove yourself, distance yourself, but it might be you're not able to. So another example maybe is at work, even as not necessarily children, even as adults, you might be in your workplace.
It happens all the time.
Right next to you.
Yep.
And they're saying things that maybe against your faith, and you want to defend it, but in the defense will lead to maybe a sin or something like that. Like I'm saying, coming back to you, you mentioning about distance. Sometimes it's harder to achieve than...
It is harder.
Yeah, what do you do?
But, yes, there are everyday occasions that people at work, they find themselves in a very uncomfortable situation. I will give you an example. Like all the colleagues, they go to drink after, like, Friday when they finish work. I don't know if they do it here, but in Perth, some companies, they do it. And this Christian guy says, I don't want to go and drink and talk about things that they will make my conscience unclean. And he's right. So there, the way that others respect you, if you're a Muslim and you do your prostrations during the day, they have to respect you if you say, sorry, but after work, my wife is waiting, and I can't. I promised I have to go every Friday because she needs me there. You find an excuse. You find a way out. It's not easy every time, but there is no occasion that nothing can be done. If nothing can be done, it means that you're in the wrong place. So, for example, if your family associates with other young families, they have young children, your kids, straight away, they have Christian friends. That's extremely important because they have people to associate with. So you create within this parish, within your circle, you create the environment for your a healthy environment for your kids to grow. And then if the school is not valuing the Christian values, you change the school. And if some of his friends are in another school and they're not far, you do that, you get them there. So there are ways out, but every problem has to be discussed individually, and you find a solution with your spiritual father and after prayer. And it's not always easy, but usually there is a way out. Otherwise, God wouldn't have given us this challenge. And the way out could be for us to grow, or for us to move, or for us to change things around us.
Father, you mentioned quite a lot the notion of a spiritual father. For some people, it's in some churches, or for some people today, this is in monastic society. Obviously, it's a normal thing. It's very important. But in the modern, I would say, mainstream churches, sometimes it's not understood and not valued, or not maybe understood. So maybe if you could touch upon that, the importance of having one to one's salvation and the relationship. You did say quite a lot, but just to sort of emphasize a little bit, and that relationship there. How it is for one's salvation. Why does one need one?
Yes. So if you want to be healthy, you need to find your physician. If you want to win the Olympic Games, you need a trainer to train you for a long time and intensively. If you want to enter the kingdom of God, you need help from someone who knows about it, someone who God has put as his representative on earth. So the spiritual father is not just an idea. It's not just us trying to find someone to help us. There is a sacrament there, and this is the authority that Jesus has passed on to his apostles, and the apostles to the bishops, and the bishops to the other bishops, and then it comes down to the spiritual fathers, and this is the authority to forgive sins. So we have situations that people were not even Christian, and they became saints. How? By giving their blood for Christ at the last minute. But we don't always have this opportunity, and even if we do, it doesn't mean that I will let someone kill me to become a saint. I will defend myself, and etc. So it's not exactly the easiest way out. But the safest way out for our salvation is after our baptism, which forgives all the sins, to have a spiritual father. And I'm not saying not to go for confession if we get baptized as adults before the baptism. But what I'm saying is that after the baptism, we can't have another baptism that will forgive everything. So we need a spiritual father, and through the confession, our sins are getting forgiven. And it's so essential as Holy Communion. So without these two, we don't have sacramental life. And without sacramental life, there is no life of prayer, because these are what helps us to cleanse our soul and to get closer to God. And without this and without prayer, we're basically on our own hands. And our own hands can lead us far away from God instead of getting us close to God. I don't know if this covers anything further. But trust me, we all need a spiritual father. And even our archbishop has one. So that's how it is. Anything else? We said a lot.
I just want to ask, what's the greatest threat to Christianity? Is it like our own self-destructiveness, or is it like like external forces?
One time in a Muslim country, there was this Christian lady, and she got into a bus. And a Muslim went closer to her very aggressively and told her, what's the greatest thing about your faith? He was very angry. And she couldn't, she was afraid for her life, so she was speechless. He repeated, what's the greatest thing about your faith? She didn't say anything, but he kept repeating, what's the greatest thing about your faith? And she said, I don't know. And this Muslim guy told her, is that we are fighting you for so many years and we can't destroy you. So nothing can beat the church. The church has the Holy Spirit. Nothing can beat God. Nothing can beat the Holy Spirit. Nothing can beat us. If they kill us, they make us saints. They killed Jesus and they gave the resurrection to everyone. It doesn't make sense, and it doesn't make sense for them, but this is what happened. So our worst enemy for the Christianity individually is ourselves. And if we were to take it a step further, the fathers of the church, they say that the biggest weapon of the devil is despair. Because Peter denied Christ 3 times and he ended up in heaven. He was an apostle. But Judas denied him and betrayed him once. But because he despaired, he lost his soul. So don't worry about Christianity. Nothing can touch our church, regardless what happens in the world. But worry about our own salvation, every one of us. And for our own soul, the worst thing that could ever happen to us is to despair. And this is another subject, but despair, if we despair, is like a blasphemy against the Holy Spirit. It's like we say to God that my sins are greater than your blood, than your sacrifice. This is a very proud thing, and it's something that cannot be forgiven because we don't want Christ to forgive us. Because if we were, we would repent. We just want to have this idea that our sins are greater than His mercy. But it's not. There is nothing that cannot be forgiven. That's it? Anything else?
Thank you.
All right. Thank you so much. Thank you, Father.